can't see that. Is that good?
Good enough.
Like, my entire childhood, all I wanted to do was be a Marine. That's it. Even in high school, I'd be like, oh, I don't need to learn this shit. I'm joining the Marines. And obviously that came back to bite me in the ass because, you know, I joined the Marines and, I'm out now. I did it. And now I don't know what the hell to do. I just thought that, like, if I had done that, it would give me the confidence to do anything.
Do you feel that you can do anything you want?
Well, I feel that I can. It's just that I don't want to. I don't want to, like, just, you know, be a regular civilian. What's up, man?
Just don't scream in the babysitter. In the other room. But you can talk. Up, just don't scream.
What's up?
Yo, Kenny, what's up, dude? Is he fucking filming out there?
Yeah.
How you doing? Like a fucking million years.
I know, man. What's up?
Same shit.
Let me take this fucking thing off.
Same shit.
What the hell is that?
So fucking, I'm wired up. I'm working for you now. We just came from fucking Joey's mom's house. Yeah, I'm fucking tired. We had to wake up. We like went to the bar last night and fucking what? Yeah, dude. We fucking went to the bar last night and then like woke up mad early to do like this like dev like organize like this like walk for veterans.
I saw that.
We had to go do that and then like film the interview with her and it was just like fucking tired.
I could talk about Joseph all day. I'm going to tell Joseph stories to the day I die. I'm going to tell my grandchildren and anybody that wants to listen. And this is my thought. If you don't want to hear me talk about my son, bye.
I feel like this is intervention right now. Like you guys are about to be like, you have a drinking problem.
Intervention.
Is this an intervention? Is this that show Catfish?
Who am I looking at, you or Doss? Kenny? I can't do this. It's fucking funny.
I mean, I've told you more on camera than I've told, you know, my own family. I've told, you know, people here in New York that I'm friends with. Because you've asked for it, honestly, and because you deserve to know for this project.
Honestly, I wouldn't be able to do this if, like, I'm already awkward enough on the camera and I, like, don't know what I'm saying. Sometimes I'm losing my train of thought. So if I was to, like, be interviewed by anybody about Afghanistan, unless it was, you know, if it wasn't you and Doss, I wouldn't be able to do it. I wouldn't feel comfortable telling them about anything. I wouldn't be able to do it. I just couldn't talk to it. I wouldn't want to either. Because I'd be like, what the fuck do you want to know about this, you know? Yeah. With you guys, I feel comfortable talking about it. And I miss it. I miss talking about this kind of stuff. I do. Because you don't have people like this back here, you can kind of, who understand. You know, you know, I say stuff and Doss is over here nodding his head like, yeah, I felt the same way. Here, people just kind of give you that like, I think you should see somebody, you know, and it's like, fuck you. What, so they can hear my war stories? Fuck them. They don't deserve to hear my fucking war stories.
Growing up, all I wanted to do, I watched all kinds of commando movies. All that shit, you know, like, it was the only thing I wanted to do was just go play guns.
I joined the Marine Corps at 19 years old because one of my good friends got killed in Iraq, and I figured I would just join to, you know, support the cause, finish the mission.
I pretty much went in there and was like, okay, like, don't bullshit me, like, I already know, like, what you're gonna say to try to get me to enlist, like, if I'm already sold, just I'm not gonna join unless it's an infantry job, so.
Just a challenge, I guess. I just wanted to see if I could do it.
Did you join thinking you were gonna go to war?
Yeah.
I went over there basically just to, you know, you see somebody in a fight, you gotta have their back, no matter if you believe in the cause or not, you know? So I just went over there to stack some bodies and do my part.
He just came home one day and said, Ma, I joined the Marines. And
I put my hands around his throat and pushed him into the wall and said, "You're not going into the military. If anybody's going to take your life, I am." And then I just accepted it.
You can't be 19 forever, you know. I was living with this old Korean War veteran, and he told me that. He's like, "You can't be 19 forever." And I was just like, "All right." It's like on the way to work one day, I like rolled a lean blunt, and I was drinking a little bit of SoCo. Yeah, dude, on the way to work. It was bad. I just didn't care, you know? 19 years old. And then, I just went to the recruiting station, mangled.
I played G.I. Joes in the sandbox and, you know, poured lighter fluid on everything and just set everything on fire before, you know. I watched the Rambo movies, I watched all, you know, like it was always a cool idea, but September 11th is what cemented it. That's it, definitely. I said, now we have an enemy, we're going to war, and I want to be there.
Hey, what's up?
First deployment wasn't, I'd say, it was more, I got a taste of the good part of it. You know, we didn't lose anybody close to us or nothing, and it was, you know, we just fucked shit up. It was like, I felt invincible for a little bit, you know? Like, you come back and you're like, damn, like, I just went into this hostile, like, place that nobody's been to in a long-ass time, supposedly one of the most dangerous places in the world, and I fucking stomped all over it, you know?
We went over there and it was like a victory for us. We didn't lose anybody, we came back. We still were in the Marines. We still had to do another. We knew we had another deployment coming ahead of us. I'm not going to speak for everybody, but I'm pretty sure most of us didn't have a hard time coming back from our first deployment.
Because it wasn't so bad the first time. You know, it's the second time.
How about the second time?
Second time was horrible.
It is going to be the biggest operation of its kind in Afghanistan, and it's probably going to be tough. We hear varying estimates of how many truly bad guys are in there, but enough that there are going to be some tough days ahead. Most of you joined the Marine Corps to be in this very condition, and now, by golly, here you are.
The Taliban had gotten a lot better, I'd say, than they were in Garbser. When we came back in Marja, it seemed like they kind of, you know, were more aggressive and more on their game.
Whoa, wow! Shit. Woo! God, hey, they're getting better! Woo!
Fuck, man.
Like, I remember within our first few patrols out of there, we lost Smitty and Angus in, and Rupture got hurt. And it was, like, literally one of the first patrols, and it just kind of set the tone to a different level. It's like the Taliban had kind of learned our standard operating procedures and they knew how to use it against us.
You
day that Daniel and Zachary died, the platoon was on a combat patrol in an area known to harbor a large number of the enemy. When the shooting started, I tasked Daniel's squad with occupying an overwatch position that could provide cover for another squad to move across open terrain with very little cover or concealment. Zachary led the way under fire, moved into the building, and was wounded by that first IED. With no regard whatsoever for his own life or safety, Daniel ran into the kill house, shouting as he went to others to watch out for secondaries, to watch where they stepped. When he got in there, he turned to carry for Zachary. He ordered others out of the building from his squad, knowing full well the risks that were inherent in what he was doing. His final words were words of care for Zachary. Zachary and Daniel died heroes, died Marines.
I promised his dad, dude. I promised Smitty's dad that he'd be all right, which I know is like cliche, you know, I got your son, you know, I got him. But like, we were at his wedding and his son, his father and his mother were like, you know, Zell, we're really glad that we know who he's with, you know? Like, they're like, we're really glad, you know? And I was just like, you know, he's safe with me, you know what I mean? And so like I told, that was like the first thing that popped in my head. I was like, yeah, I promised his dad he'd be all right. And he's over there getting shot up with morphine, you know? He was done, dude. He was wasted. Like there was like fucking like five people working on him. And like, what fucks me up is I like accepted it. Like I was like, fuck. I was like, that's it. Like, you know, like how do you come back from that? That half of you are, you know, you're gone. And then the second one went off and Angus just disappeared. And I was just like, what the fuck, man? What the hell is going on? At that point, I was like, dude, please give me somebody to fucking kill. I was like, please, like, and like, there was nobody, dude. I didn't grieve or do anything, you know, the rest of the deployment. I wanted to die. You know, it was like, please, you know, end it now, you know, like why? Let's do this shit.
Woo! Nice.
Every like week we had people getting helicoptered out and, you know, firefights every day.
I mean, it's not nerve-wracking because you're worried about yourself. To be honest with you, you just don't want to hear on the radio that somebody else died who you know.
What was that?
Covering fire, let's go!
You hit that building over there!
Wait a minute,
hey, watch your back!
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Yo, I'm on my left!
Oh, we're good.
I'm on my left, double
support! You alright?
Right here.
Hey,
you're right, dude. Hey, we need that back.
Kruger.
I don't see an exit wound.
Hey, man, look at me.
You're right, dude?
Kruger.
Wait, which building you just hit? The fucking one we were taking contact from.
Look at me. Hold that. You all right, dude?
Kruger.
Hey, are you all right?
Flair, want to push this way to get...
Kruger.
Hey, let's be holding some security.
Pressure.
Watch that way.
Roger.
You all right, Smith?
We're taking contact.
Kruger.
Tango, 7, hey. Building 4.
Look at me.
You know, the first time we came home, we didn't lose anybody. Really, I'm not going to lie to you, it wasn't really that much contact. And the second deployment, we lost people. We had contact every day, sometimes 2-3 times a day, just trying to fight to keep our fob. You know, like it, coming home from that, you're in a stressful environment for 7 months. And you come home and you get thrown into the civilian population.
Two weeks ago, I shot a Mark 19 at a dude and I blew his shoes off of his feet, you know? And it's like now I'm holding a baby and I have to change a diaper.
going through that, and then like 2 weeks later, you're at home like chilling with your family at fucking Denny's, and it's like, I don't know. It's a different, it's a lot different.
What was it like when you got back from Marja?
When I got back from Marja, it was, I was getting out soon, so I was kind of checked out mentally of the Marine Corps. I'd had enough, you know, I couldn't wait to get out and be a civilian again.
After the second deployment, I was done, you know?
Kind of realized, yeah, it's probably not for me, you know? I'll do what most infantrymen do 4 years and get out.
When I got out, I collected unemployment for 6 months.
How did that work out?
It worked out. I mean, unemployment's really not that much money, but it, you know, covered the bills until I got hired as a cop.
When I got out, I drove home. I was home within like 2 weeks, and I started working like a week within being home. So I was like, you know, saw everybody, said hi, and it was just like, boom, straight to work for the rest of the summer.
I just tried to relax the first 2-3 months, I believe. Just wanted to relax at home, sit at home, do nothing, watch TV, walk around, you know, like, just get back to like trying to get back into how it is not to have like a wake up at 5:30, 6 o'clock schedule. Just wanted to relax and have no pressure on me.
First, the day I got home, I was living, I went back to my parents' house, and then I was only there for about maybe 2 or 3 weeks, and then I moved in with my sister.
I decided to look for a job. So yeah, it was enough time, you know, being out. Let me find a job. That didn't go well.
And then I started going to community college, but I only went for one semester, and then I dropped out because, like, when I first started school, I went through this little phase where I was like, wow, this is so easy compared to everything in the Marine Corps. All I have to do is just go to class and then do my homework. You know, I can wake up at like 9. I don't have to wake up at 7. You know, I thought everything was so easy. And then, like, little by little, like, going to class started to just, like, irritate the shit out of me.
Yeah, I collected unemployment for a little bit and tried school and just drank my face off and was just kind of living stagnantly. And I was like, you know what? This isn't, like, great people. But at the same time, like, I couldn't party, or when I'd get drunk and I'd want to talk about, like, shit about overseas, I didn't have that outlet anymore. You know what I mean? I didn't have somebody I could go knock on the door and be like, yo, remember this, and start talking, you know? And so you just kind of keep it to yourself. And I don't know if that's a good thing or not, but maybe it is, because you don't want to scare your roommates.
Why do you think it's harder for an infantryman to readjust than other veterans?
I don't know. I really don't know why.
What? They do the fighting and the killing? And
I guess, like, dude, honestly, that shit's fun, though. Like, that shit is so much fun. Like, who wouldn't want to just be like, all right, you guys ready? Like, let's go do this. You know, like, yeah, like, people are going to get hurt, you know? And it sucks, you know, but like, that's what you asked for, I guess.
Hey, I'm going. Are
you ready?
Yeah.
Let's go. The combat like makes you feel powerful because it's like literally like, you're wielding ability to kill somebody. You're wielding like deadly force, and at the same time you're confronting deadly force.
I was scared during combat. I was fucking scared. Regardless of that, even though I still miss it.
It's the rush, definitely. It's just like, the, you know, it turns you into an adrenaline junkie. So it's like, it sucks when you're in it, but then like, if you're not around it, you miss it.
You know, life after combat and after you've like done some shit and seen some shit, it seems very vanilla sometimes.
All you have to do is not die over there. You don't have to pay bills. You don't have to fucking go to work. You don't have to go to school. You don't fucking have to do homework. And I think that's part of the problem, is, you know, not being able to fucking deal with life on life's terms, basically.
What do you want civilians to know or understand about you or just combat vets in general?
That we're not them, and there's no way in hell that we'll ever be them or relate to them. And to just leave it alone.
Yeah, you'll buy me a beer, but then you'll ask me if I killed somebody. As far as I'm concerned, like, you can keep your beer, just don't ask your ridiculous questions. You know?
You wanna tell him?
Oh no, I always tell the truth. You killed somebody, yes. And then, what? So what did you think? I told you I was in the Marine Corps infantry. I told you I was in Afghanistan twice. What do you think?
There's a disconnect. There's a severe human disconnect. And I don't know what it is or how to pinpoint it. And the communication for me with real people, you know, because I'm not a real person, I guess. The disconnect with the human population is really hard. Fortunately for me, I live in an area where a lot of these people are either Marines or were Marines or, you know, military or whatever. And they understand, you know, and people are a lot more patient here. But, you know, going home, visiting family and stuff like that, it's just, you know, I run my mouth a lot when I'm talking to my buddies. You know, I can talk to you forever. I'll talk to you for hours. I go home, I don't say a fucking word.
I don't talk to my wife about exactly what happens in Afghanistan. I don't talk to her about my deployments or in military in general. It's my choice why I was there, not hers. So it's kind of like on me to deal with that.
I don't know. Sometimes it's frustrating to try and explain like how you feel about it. Like I didn't ever really get too specific about certain things, like unless I was drinking. But it's hard to get people to understand you without, without confusing them or, like, you're afraid that they're gonna think different about you, like based off of what you've been through. And that's kind of something you're worried about, or something that I was worried about all the time. It's like, you know, I didn't want my family to know certain things about me because I'd feel like they'd, they'd either feel sorry for me or they'd be, you know, worried about me. And both of those are are something that I want to avoid, so.
What did you experience during the war that you thought was memorable or left an impression on you?
Oh, there's too many things to name in one sitting.
First, just two that come to mind.
Well, killing someone and seeing a dead body and touching a dead body, definitely.
I usually tell people I've never done anything. I've never done anything. You know? Well, but you went to Iraq and you went to Afghanistan. What did you do there? It was a deployment like anybody else. Because sometimes I really don't know. How do you look at somebody and be like, you know, like, I shot this dude in the fucking head and it was awesome. Why was it awesome? How is taking a human life? Someone created this, you know? Like, God loved this person and you just blew him away and you think it's great. You know why? Because I was pinned down and he was shooting at me and I saw him before he saw me and I plugged him first. And it was great because he was trying to kill me and I killed him instead. There's something like that. It's like, people don't get that. They look at you and they're like, oh, you know, that's all they say. And you don't know what they're thinking. You can't read minds. You don't know what they're thinking. So it's like, I just keep my mouth shut. It's like, man, I don't even know what to tell you about that. You know?
So the last person I killed, I made sure he looked me in the eyes. And I looked him in the eyes and I said, you know, I wish we could speak the same language because you're done right now. You're done. And I drew up on him and I shot him in the face and I watched the bullet go in between his eyes and I watched it come out behind his ear and I watched the life come out of his face and he fell on the ground, and that's an image I can't get out of my head, because the image of someone dying as you look them in the eyes is nightmarish. It's something no one should ever see.
But it's not just something you just justify and like get over, even if it's right, like even if you were able to do it in that situation, like that doesn't mean that it's gonna be a cakewalk to deal with. So
just an odd thing that sums up the Afghanistan for me is I remember one time, like this is in Jugram, like a lot of stuff was going on. We take contact the whole way to this building. We finally got on the roof of this building. We took more contact, and then out of nowhere, I remember seeing this guy like pretty close. I'd say like 50 meters, stand up out of the high grass of poppies, and looks like he's just like completely out of place because like I said, shit's going down. It was the day we pushed Jugram. Like there's no like why you're out in the field. I have no idea. Like why you're not running for your life, I have no idea. And every once in a while, AT4, you know, RDA will go off. Something will go off, and it'll boom, and he'll sit down and crouch. I was like, what the fuck is this guy doing here? I was like, this dude's like definitely up to no good. He didn't have a weapon on or nothing, but we started taking more rounds closer, and you know, I was like, fuck it, this guy's got to be spotting or something, because there's why he's still here during this massive firefight. I don't know. So I lit him up, and then I remember finding out a few days later that he was blind and deaf. You know, what if he wasn't blind and deaf? But that's just it's the weird shit like that that you don't see in the movies and shit, just how weird shit is, you know? Like, you could be a blind, deaf dude minding your business and you'll just get shot. And that sucks, but it's, nobody said war was pleasant.
Dude, me and Doss had to pick up that body.
Yeah. I remember, I felt bad about that. I apologize.
I walked out there with this kid.
Yeah. Yep.
I had to carry someone's this corpse that had been in the sun for like 2 weeks and had been eaten up by dogs and stuff. I had to carry him in front of his son through a field so that the son and his family could claim the guy's dead body. And when we were carrying him, we were crossing a wadi, and the guy's corpse, the bottom of his foot rubbed up against my hand, and the flesh just rubbed off all on my hand. And it stunk, and it was disgusting, and just a terrible memory. So before, I kind of like, you know, I felt bad for the kid. Like, you know, I would get drunk and get upset about it, but I was drunk, you know. But before, I felt like, you know, I did feel bad for the kid, but at the same time, I was still in kind of like, you know, fuck every Afghan, you know. So I was kind of, I would bounce back and forth between fuck him or I kind of feel bad for the kid. But when my dad died, I kind of rethought that. And I started to think about, I can remember, you know, looking at the hospital bed and looking at my dad's dead body. And
So, hang on, I want to say this.
So I was, think about what it's like to see, you know, my dad's dead body on a hospital bed. And I thought about what it would be like to see him in a field after he'd been shot up and laid in the sun for about 2 weeks and been eaten by dogs. And I have had a dream a couple times about that, like, go out to pick that dude up and it was my dad. So I kind of really feel bad for that kid now.
I don't do drugs.
You pour the dope in the spoon, and then you draw water up in the needle, and then you squirt it into the spoon, and then you take this and stir it around, and then you put it back in, and you drop a piece of cotton in there, and you stick it like that and draw it up, and then you fucking flick it and get all the bubbles out and shit, and then you're good to go.
First time I tried heroin, I was at my friend's apartment. There was three of us there. They were shooting it up. I didn't shoot it up the first time I did it. I snorted it, and first time I snorted it, you know, I felt amazing. You know, I didn't feel sad. I felt so happy. It made my day great, you know? And then I, you know, when I'd come down and I'd feel, come back to reality, you know, I would just get depressed again and just wouldn't be happy. I would just be miserable. So I'd, you know, get high again. And then you can only do that stuff so many times in a row before, you know, you get addicted. And when you get addicted, it's all over.
This is where I did basically all the heroin for the most part. This bag is full of dope bags. Each one of these little things is about $10, $20. And you can see there's tons of them in there.
I was just fucked up every day for a long time.
How long?
Multiple years. Just about 3 years. At first it was alcohol and weed, and then it moved to just heroin and weed.
What do you think is the toughest thing to deal with when you get home?
Toughest thing to deal with when you get home would be to, how to deal with other people first and foremost. Specifically, like, probably your family and your significant other and friends from back home that can't really relate to, like, your experiences. So.
What do you do to deal with them?
I don't know, I think everybody has their own way.
I was, you know, kind of getting depressed a lot at the time and not really just sad. I, you know, think about, you know, friends of mine who died over there or just, you know, things like that, and it would upset me, and I was having trouble sleeping and just not, you know, miserable. And when I tried that shit, I was happy as fuck.
For me, I was definitely drinking a lot. I don't know. That, I think that's like the default. Everybody gets home and has problems like boom, like substance abuse in one form or another.
I, you know, it took away all my problems, but obviously, you know, that lasts for all of, you know, fucking 2 weeks. Then, you know, you're getting withdrawals and you gotta, every single moment of your life is dedicated to chasing that fucking high. If I wasn't high, I wasn't happy. And then it became, even when I was high, I wasn't happy, so. What made me stop was I realized how much I was hurting my mom. My father had died, and she was already, you know, upset, obviously, over that. And I just felt really awful. I felt really guilty being a huge burden on her. I felt like she was already going through losing her best friend and her husband. She didn't need to worry about her son being a heroin addict. And that's the main reason I stopped.
That's what kind of like brought about me really cutting back on my alcohol consumption. It's like a couple of drunken episodes like with my brothers and my dad, and you know, once you see them like worried about you, that's what really kind of like, it drove me to stop drinking, at least for, you know, 4 or 5 months, was like seeing my dad worried about me, because, you know, get on a rampage one night when it's just like, you know, you and your brothers and your dad, and you know, my brother's a Marine, and so you get two Marines around each other and they can't fucking shut up about military shit, you know. And that just progressed into, you know, more drinking and more complicated stories. And then yeah, kind of looped out, and I could kind of tell my dad was worried about me and my brothers. I was like, you know what? I can just, I don't need this to manifest itself when I'm at my worst. when I'm like, you know, blackout drunk. So I've definitely, you know, like I said, I quit drinking for like probably a solid 4 months. And since then, I don't really binge too hard anymore on the booze. Yeah. And they're worried about me too, because like my grandpa was, a Marine in Korea, and he came home and like turned into a, you know, an alcoholic, ended up dying from being an alcoholic. So I think it's safe to say that I got the gene.
Do you understand why I drank that?
Oh yeah. And I tried to, you know, that's like something that I got into like with a conversation with my dad when I was drunk, like, you know, I know why grandpa drank. So.
Like, I know we go to a baseball game, I can't get us a seat in the middle. He has to be in the end. If we go to a restaurant and they try to sit us next to somebody, gotta tell the server no, we have to move. Just all those stupid things like that that I don't even make a big deal of. I just, you know, I don't really know when I noticed it. I guess right when you came home. I don't really know. Because you weren't like that before.
I just don't like fucking being like this with other people I don't know. Like, I don't like people touching me. I don't like people getting too close to me, invading my space. Like I got personal space, and I don't like people taking that away from me. You know? I don't know if they're dirty. I don't know who they are. I don't know if they touch. Don't touch me. I don't like that, you know?
Was that something that, I mean, is that different, or was that?
I was never like that. I could sit next to anybody. Now I really just can't. Like, I need my personal space. And like I said, it could be deployment. It could be being a cop, because I don't like people being too close to me.
What did you do in that 6 months that you were unemployed?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Probably is deployment, yeah.
I like to be with my back against the wall. Don't know what's going on behind me. I mean, to other people, that might sound like PTSD. To me, that just sounds like a hard time adjusting, you know? And maybe it's a good thing, because in my head, I think I'm safer like that. Because, I don't know. It's something that helped me get through war. You know, all these little things that you pick on and you worry about, little signs that you see here and there, that kind of helped you out. You knew when an ambush was coming or whatever else, and kind of, you see that that's the thing that helps you go through. And when you come back out, you're like, well, hey, it helped me there, why not here? Everybody out there is trying to get you in one way or another. If they're not going to shoot at you, they're going to point out where you're at, and they're going to help them out. So it's kind of hard to get rid of that mentality when you get back home. You know, like, to trust someone, it's really hard.
You expect the worst, which turns you into kind of a bitter, shitty person, because I always look at people in the worst way. You know, when I meet people, I usually don't trust them right off the bat or nothing. My own family, even, like, I'm guilty of that, you know? Like, you think that, like, you assume the worst in people because you've seen the worst in human nature. If that makes any sense, I don't know.
PTSD treatment, you know, they say that hypervigilance is a symptom of PTSD, you know? I think hypervigilance is a good thing, because if I'm always alert, yeah, I'm wearing myself out, I'm stressing myself out over stuff, but using it in a way that I'm using to protect my family, I'm sleeping better at night because my kids are asleep too. So,
you know what's happened to me a lot, which is weird? Like, for the first year, I was having dreams of patrols I'd never been on. And at the end of my dream, it would be like, all right, yeah, I that patrol never happened. And that was happening, like, every day. Every day, like, I was, you know, passing out drunk or whatever.
I analyze the shit out of it every day, because the memories come in. Call them flashbacks or whatever the hell you want to call it.
You know, I don't know what it is. You know, the memories, the intrusive memories come in every time. Every time I change a diaper, it's like trying to hold someone down and trying to wipe their fucking, you know, trying to pack a wound when you're trying to wipe an ass. I don't know why. That's what I think about.
I think about the day Smitty and Angus get killed. All the time, man. And like, it's not like, you don't ask for it.
You will not go one day without thinking about it. You will not go to sleep one night without thinking about it.
Do you think you'll ever stop thinking about it?
No. I've tried. I've thought about it, you know. Not if you can say, I've gotten drunk, I've gotten high, I've done this, I've done that. I've changed my location, I've changed my company. And I always stopped thinking about it, so I decided that, well, I'm going to go on with my life and...
Pretty... Sometimes, like, I don't look through it like I used to. Like, I used to read the letters, and...
Yeah.
Now it's like... I can go back. I can probably...
Those green Right in the Rain books. Mm. Everybody had them.
This one?
Yep.
This one.
Those are, like, a kind of status symbol. Like, if you carry a green book, you're, like, kind of important sometimes. Here's some Afghan money.
Some money?
Yeah. Afghan money.
Yeah, it's some...
That's actually... That might be Pakistani money. Unless it says to Afghanistan. Yeah, that's Pakistan money.
Really?
Yep. That's probably came from
Taliban. His journals. Things that he wrote. 3/17/10. For the push, I left my book on the truck. I know he wrote some other... He didn't write too much. You can read it.
Yeah. I decided the other day, well, yesterday, there might be something wrong with me. I enjoy getting shot at. It's like a cheap thrill. There is just something about the snap around makes as it flies past you. Maybe it's some kind of animal instinct. As soon as I hear the first shot, I go into hunt mode, scanning for anything that's abnormal. I spotted 3 hides the other day because of a dust cloud the AK made as it shot. The shimmer of the barrel and a head. I also noticed that although there was no wind, somehow a cloud of ground hay was kicked up behind a haystack. For a while I thought I was of firefights, especially when there was 13 days without a break, but yesterday changed that for me. I'm pretty sure that I will never find something to compete with the way that a firefight makes me feel. I hope that I can come close with racing or fighting fires, but how am I going to know? How old was your son when he joined the Marine Corps?
Joseph was 19. He went to college for a year, and it wasn't for him, and he just decided he was going in the Marines.
Did you notice any difference in him from when he was in college into when he came home after boot camp?
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. Big difference. He still was Joseph, the same personality, but he grew up.
What about Afghanistan? How do you feel when you're gone?
Afghanistan was tough. I can't say it was exciting. I was proud. I was scared to death. I missed him. And when he came back, it was good to have him back, but he was different. When he got out of the Marines, it wasn't any better. He was lost, he was quiet. He had been diagnosed with PTSD, his short-term memory loss. He had reoccurring nightmares. I can't be in his head. I can only tell you what I saw. And when you see your son and you have his siblings there saying there's something wrong with him, there's something wrong, and he's talking in the mirror to himself going, I'm a Marine, I don't need any help. And then just going back to Afghanistan and reliving things and saying it out loud, and you really hear, and it crushes you. And he came down to the bottom of the stairs. And God, I'll never forget this. He was going for the door. He kind of yelled at his brother because his brother wanted to come down and help him. I'm like, Tyler, shh, stay up there because he's going to flip out. And he yelled at Tyler, but he still wasn't here because he didn't call him by Tyler.
and he came to reach the doorknob like he was leaving, and I touched his back and he just broke down. And he couldn't understand why this had happened, why he's like that, why. And he just cried and cried, and all I could do is sit there with my arms around him, sitting on the floor. It wasn't good, but he knew after that he had to stop drinking. And he did, but he's still going out and coming home and saying, I feel like I don't belong, and feeling lost. It hurts, because I can't help. It's something that you guys and Joseph would have had to, you have to, I don't know what you have to do. You have to, I think you have to talk about it.
What did he call you about?
He told me about, I guess there was, the Taliban was, I don't know if they were building behind a wall, and there was a firefight, and they started firing RPGs, and I guess you guys had to make a choice whether to fire a rocket or not. And I don't think that you were aware of, or maybe you were, but you didn't really have a choice, and you fired that rocket, and the firefight stopped, and you have to go over to see what happened. Because I couldn't understand why he had to go back over there. And I had to witness and see the kids that were killed and the women that died. I don't know how you live with that. I don't know. And it hurts. And I know that you live with that. And you, and a whole bunch of other guys, and I don't know, it's not a good thing. It's just to watch your kids go through that. And yes, he was a man, and yes, he chose this. But our government made the rules, and they're not there. And it's wrong. You make them feel guilty, and then you don't help them after. You know, you go to the VA, you get diagnosed before you get out of the Marines, and you call the VA, and the VA says, oh, send us an email. So you send them an email, and 2 weeks later they send you an email saying you'll hear from us in 8 to 10 weeks. Well, 8 weeks later he was dead. Where were you?
How would you say that combat influenced his death?
To live for the thrill. I've never been in the field being shot at. I would be scared to death. But I guess if you listen to him, listen, read his stories, or if you were able to read his journals and you listen to that, the adrenaline when you're being shot at and you're firing back, and will you ever experience that again? And obviously you'll never experience that, knock on wood. But I think that driving his car fast and pushing it as far as he could and controlling it, controlling a situation, controlling a car, is him trying to get that same adrenaline rush that he got in Afghanistan. I don't know if it was an anxiety attack, or if he was just too stupid to drive so fast on a road that he knew he shouldn't drive fast on, that he talked about not driving fast on. And in an instant, he's doing what he loves to do. He's driving that damn car of his and speeding. And it's just like in a flash, he was gone. And the good thing is that he didn't suffer. He died instantly. The bad thing is that a lot of other people hurt for it. A lot. It sucks. Because to know, like, the last 6 months of your life, that's what you lived with and had to deal with every day. And my God, he was going, it's like 2 years and 8 months now. And you guys still have to deal with it. And I can't, I want to say I feel sorry for you. And yet, I just hope that you realize that it's, maybe it's never going to go away, but you did nothing wrong. And maybe to keep going and to think about it, think about Joseph, Angus, Smitty, DeForges, and say, you guys got to keep going and to honor them. Who's going to keep talking about them? So maybe that's what you do to keep going. So just you guys and everybody else that watches this, think of the people you lost and then say, I'm going to live to honor them. I'm going to tell their stories. So you just keep going and think of the future. You have futures. Mm-hmm. Everybody has a future. Maybe these guys went before you because they want you to see you have a future. I'm going to keep living. I'm going to honor them every single day, every day, no matter what.
Miss your squad?
Do I miss my squad? Yeah, I definitely miss my squad. I miss a lot of guys from the platoon. I miss a lot of guys from the company. It's hard, like, it's one, I'm gonna say something that's probably gonna give a good reason why people don't hang out after they leave. You, while in the military, you guys become really good friends. And I'll tell you my specific reason. When I got in the military, I just wanted to relax a little bit, you know, maybe see, hook up with old friends, you know, family, whatever, and you see, they're not what they used to be. So you kind of start missing your friends or whatever. And my specific case, when my friend, I don't know if I can name him, he got into a car accident and I had to go see him. I had to drive up to Connecticut and see him. And it's really hard for me to see him getting hurt. Him dying, he died. So just not being there, it's kind of, I felt like maybe it would have been easier if he would have died in combat, you know? Like, I knew he died for a purpose, you know? For us, and it would have, it just happened. But coming here and just something happened to him like that, I know it's an accident, but I felt like I couldn't do that anymore, you know? Like, I didn't want to hear if anybody else got hurt. And I kind of stayed away from everybody after that. I just didn't want to hear any bad news. So, I do miss them.
I'll never say that they died for no reason, because you know what, they died to keep the people next to them alive, you know. And I guarantee you, they would say that they would, you know, I know I would rather get killed than see one of my friends get killed, and I'm sure they felt the same way, you know. So they didn't die for no reason. They didn't die for Afghanistan. They didn't die for America. They died for us.
Like, when I got there, it was all about, you know, God, country core, that bullshit, like, and then by the time you leave, it's just like, you know what, I'm not doing this for anybody other than the dudes, like, right next to me.
You got somebody that you know, you love, and you'd do anything for, and you know they'd do anything for you, and then they die, and then the only thing you can do is to turned to another dude, man. You know, like, what are you gonna do, you know? Like, what the fuck are you gonna do, man? You know, you can open up a book, you know? Okay, thank you, God, you know? It's like, seriously, man, there are no answers up or down, you know? You don't communicate with another person, you ain't gonna get anywhere with it.
If you could give like a piece of advice, like say you're an old dude now, you're an old man, and like there's some new generation coming home from a war, what would you tell them?
Coming home from a war?
Yeah.
You know, I'd let them know, like, you know, things could get rough, but it'll get better. Like if you need somebody to talk to, don't hesitate to talk to somebody, because when you hesitate to talk, it's too late.
I remember coming home and like I said it wasn't anymore. I could walk down the door, knock on Doss's door, your door, and you know, at any time of the day or night, drunk, and we could shoot the shit and laugh. It's like, you know, people got, everybody's doing different things, you know? It is kind of like you lose a family when you get out.
There's things I can't talk to family members about that, or even if I do, you know, it would be pointless. They wouldn't understand. But the guys we were with, you can talk to about anything, you know? They were there, they know. They were the ones, you know, who had your back.
At some point, you watched my back, and I've watched yours, and that's not gonna stop, ever. And that's why I do that. That's why I agreed to do this. I'll drop whatever I'm doing, anytime, any day of the week, to help one of my guys out. I'm not a Marine anymore. I don't have to hold anybody accountable. Nobody's holding me accountable. I'm accountable for myself. But this is what I've got. You guys are a part of something. That's part of me. That's it.
I don't think that our friends really died for like anybody else other than us, regardless of the rhetoric behind it. So, and that's hard to deal with at first. It's hard to like just realize that that's the case. But you know, it compelled me to look more into it. Like, what can I get out of this? Like, what can I, like, there's gotta be something that we can do with this experience. Like, it can't just be like that depressing. So it's like, you know, what I've kind of decided to do is like, you know, like if for nothing else, we can take that experience and like use it to prevent other people from having to go through that.
I believe 100% that everyone I killed was in the Taliban. I did not kill any women. I did not kill any children. Everyone was a military age male, and they were either in the Taliban or they were in direct support of the Taliban. And I'm 100% convinced of that. But the fact that it still haunts me shows that there's, you know, there's something beyond military affiliation. There's something beyond, you know, whether or not this person is trying to kill you or trying to kill your friends. There's something on a human level that, as a member of the animal kingdom, you probably shouldn't be killing your own species.
I had a girlfriend in high school, you know, I remember telling her, all right, and this is some seriously save it for later and bust my balls for it shit, you know, it was like, I remember telling her that I wanted to be a hero, you know, that was it, you know, that was like some from the heart shit. Now, like, so I go to the doctor the other day and the nurse is talking to me, you know, she's doing my paperwork and she comes in and she thanks me she's like, thank you for your service. I don't even know how to answer that. You know, it's like, there's all this shit that I wanted, you know, before I even joined. And then there's all this shit that I've been exposed to. And it's like, it's not that I want to forget it. It's not that I'm not proud of it. It's that I don't know how to react. You know, like, I want to be left alone. Like, I don't want to be thanked for my service, you know? I don't want to nod. I'm certainly not a fucking hero. I don't know. It's not something. It's not something I want to take away or something I want to get rid of or something I want to undo. But it's something I want to leave alone.
Please join the choir in singing God Bless America.
Thank you.
Come on, we got. Hey, you, come on.
One more. Very nice. Thank you.